Oh, everybody's so busy chatting, so good morning, everyone. If you don't know the person next to you, or even if you do, turn to them and say hello and how are you and hope you're doing well, all that sort of stuff. Some people are still saying hello in the coffee room, but they'll come in before we finish, I'm sure. So, some announcements to begin with. This week is our Lest We Forget exhibition, starting on Friday from 10 o'clock. Next Saturday, there's going to be cream teas, but we need you to bake, so... urgent appeal for all bakers to bake some tray bakes or scones and to leave them in. You can leave them into the coffee room next Friday morning. You can leave them in next Friday evening between 6:30 and 7:00. And I think there's a sign-up sheet in the coffee room. If you are going to bake, if you could let somebody know, because they're panicking about the number of tray bakes or the lack of them, or the number of scones or lack of them. And so please do, if you can bake at all, sure, if you'd like to make some, that would be really helpful. We want to give everybody a good experience who comes next Saturday for the cream tea. Sign up sheet in church, it says there. Next Saturday, then, Dr. Brian Walker is going to be giving a talk about two army chaplains, John Redmond and Leslie Walker, and their wartime stories and experiences. That talk at 11:30 and 3 p.m. We also know that the Mayor of Lisburn's coming, the High Sheriff of County Antrim's coming on Friday, and various other people may call in as well. The exhibition opens each day at 10 a.m. and 2 p.m. on Sunday, and runs until 4 or 5 o'clock most days. So, and then from Monday of next week to 2 o'clock each day. Next Sunday morning is Remembrance Sunday. Morning prayer and morning worship that will include an act of remembrance. Please remember that Castle Street is liable to be closed to traffic, so give extra time to come and to get parked and to get into the cathedral. We will start a little bit later next Sunday, but try and be here for 11. We'll give time for those who have gone to the War Memorial to come in. So, morning prayer, morning worship with an act of remembrance. The Christmas magazine articles are needed by Thursday, the 14th of November. And if you can get them in as soon as possible, that would make things much easier for Angela in the office, and please include your start-up dates for January. I know it feels a while away yet, but very handy to have those. There's an announcement about the men's fellowship and also about the church hall, and Simon's going to come and make those.
Good morning, everyone. Firstly, about men's fellowship. The next Men's Fellowship event is coming up on Saturday, the 23rd of November. It's going to be a breakfast event at Café Vicrin and the T3 Conference Centre with a special guest speaker, Rodney Blair. Rodney is the vicar at the Shankill Parish, Lurgan, and also the club chaplain to Lurgan Rugby Football Club. Rodney will be sharing with us stories of his life in rugby and how he came to feel the call of full-time Christian service on his life. Please come along to enjoy a nice cooked breakfast. It was very good, trust me, from last year. And great conversation with everybody else who comes along. You're very welcome to invite friends who aren't part of the cathedral family to join us as well. Places are £20 each and must be reserved in advance, either by contacting myself or Keith, or by signing up on the Church Suite event in the next few days. Secondly, hall fundraising. As you're all aware, we've been working hard to fundraise for the work required for the hall, with generosity from the council helping us to get to 20% of our £500,000 target, as well as generous giving at Harvest and one-off events such as the Golf Day. However, we need a bit more help to nudge things along now. So we're trying to apply for some bigger grants to help us get closer to the target, and that's realistically the only way we're going to be able to reach £500,000. However, in order to access the grants that are available, we need to be able to demonstrate that we've got a larger amount of committed funding already, more like £200,000 to £300,000. That doesn't necessarily mean cash in the bank, although that helps. What we're asking for you today is for you to think about what you could consider committing to giving over the course of the next 3 years. That could mean a lump sum now, a lump sum in 3 years' time, or little bits and pieces between now and then along the way. With that kind of committed funding, that enables us to go to funders to say, we've got commitment from our church family of this much money, please help us by matching some or part of it. And it does really make things a lot more straightforward for us to access a bigger range of grant funding. So please, when you go home today, would you have a think about what you might be able to commit to giving to over the course of the next few years? If you're in a position to make a commitment like this, perhaps for an additional amount per month or per quarter or per year, please contact Richard Thompson or a member of the Select Vestry or a member of the clergy to let us know. Anything at all is gratefully received, and it's only by working together, a little bit at a time, all together, that we'll work together to meet the target and get the hall ready for the next 50 years or so. Thank you. And finally, if you've got spare pairs of hands, if not donating financially, if you're able to help write grant applications or do graphic designs or do things like website updates or help us do anything at all, we would really, really welcome any volunteers of time and effort. You don't need to be a specialist in anything, but there's always jobs that we can be needing help with. So have a think about that too. Thank you.
And just to add to that, if you've got 200 or 300,000 sitting in your account, we will gladly receive it as well. So, we need to be pushing ahead with that. Thanks, Simon, for those announcements there. Rodney's a great speaker. He spoke here at Community Harvest a couple of years ago. You can also ask him how he's recovering from a broken leg from playing rugby as well. So look forward to hearing from Rodney. The Murray Opera Company is drawing closer, the 23rd of November here, and you can book for the Messiah. And seeing 12 men popping up and down around the cathedral telling the story of the Messiah in a really interactive way. Book online with www.murrayopera.co.uk, but please book as soon as possible for that. The Lisburn Community Choir and Children's Choir are having their Christmas concerts on the 7th of December here. They're at 7:30 and 3 o'clock. The 7:30 concert has two tickets left, and that's all that there is for the evening, but there are tickets for 3 o'clock, and you can book those on Ticket Source and get your tickets there. Merry and Bright, always a great concert from the Community Choir and Children's Choir. And seeing as we're talking about Christmas, I'm just disappointed Stephen hasn't got his Christmas pullover on this morning, but he's looking carol singers for the 22nd of December. All ages are welcome. He ruled me out because you need to have a modicum of singing ability. I'm going home to look up what modicum means. And also that you're able to attend rehearsals. So please speak to him or phone him or make contact with him for the carol services on the 22nd of December. Lest we forget also, they are looking a couple of items that could be helpful. I think it's a Delph Dog, is that right, Heather, wherever you are? And okay, so a garden ornament of in the shape of a dog, okay. Okay, so dogs or pigeons, if you have those in your gardens now, they need to, don't be trying to trap pigeons or anything, or bring them, but if you can bring ornaments, that would be great. Just thought about that. And also the notice sheet, hopefully you got that on the way in. If not, please pick up your notice sheet and you'll get all the details for the next couple of months on the notice sheet, and you can note them down. that would be great. So we're just going to turn to worship now. I'm going to invite the music group to come forward. This morning we're thinking about knowing God and how we can come to know Him. And in Psalm 27 and verse 4, we read these words: "One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek Him in His temple." And certainly it's a great privilege to come together to worship and to jointly look to the Lord, to experience His presence and His power and His word and His spirit. And so as we gather this morning, may we come with thankful hearts, knowing that we are called to look to Him more and more in our daily lives, but also to treasure these times of worshiping together. So let's bow our heads to pray. Lord God, we confess that we have not always made it our priority to dwell with You, to gaze on Your beauty, and to seek first Your kingdom. As we worship today, may our hearts be open to discovering You afresh, to following Your call on our lives, and to putting You first in all things. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Would you please stand? invite Kidzone to come forward and join in with Nothing is Impossible. And I think somebody's going to be doing the actions as well. So if you want to come up, and then we'll all try and keep up with you all, because you're great at these actions, aren't you? Mm-hmm. Super. And Nothing is Impossible. Kidzone and Bible class are back this week, so if you'd like to go across to the hall now, that would be great, and hope you have a wonderful time over there, guys. Just as they go, I'm just going to pray for all those going across and for their leaders. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for the joy that our children and our young people bring to our lives, for the joy that they bring to our worship, and we pray that as they go, that they may be learning more about you, to know and to rejoice in your presence, and to truly know that nothing is impossible whenever they trust in you and love you with all of their heart and soul and mind and strength. In Jesus' name, amen. And now our Bible reading is going to follow, and Lydia's going to read for us.
This morning's reading is taken from the book of Acts, beginning at chapter 17, verses 16. While Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with both Jews and God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace day by day with those who happened to be there. A group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers began the debate with him. Some of them asked, "What is this babbler trying to say?" Others remarked, "He seems to be advocating foreign gods." They said this because Paul was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. When they took him and brought him to a meeting of the Areopagus, where they said to him, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? You are bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we would like to know what they mean." All the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there spent their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, "People of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' So you're ignorant of the very thing you worship, and this is what I'm going to proclaim to you. The God who made this world and everything in it is the God of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples built by human hands, and he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. From one man he made all the nations, that they should inhabit the whole earth, and he marked out their appointed times in his history and the boundaries of their lands. God did this so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from any one of us. For in him we live, move, and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine is being like gold or silver or stone, an image made by human design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent, for he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof to this to everyone by raising him from the dead. When they heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered, but others said, 'We want to hear you again on this subject.' At that, Paul left the council. Some of the people became followers of Paul and believed. Among them was Dionysius, a member of the Areopagus, and a woman named Damaris, and a number of others." This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Lydia. Good morning, everyone. Let's pray. Father God, we want to thank you for this morning for the gift of your word. And Lord, we simply want to pray that by your Holy Spirit, you would open up your word to each of us. Lord, that you would give us ears to hear what it is you might want to speak to each of us about this morning. So Lord, we welcome you and ask that you would have your way. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. So this morning, as we continue on our journey through Acts, we are looking at Paul as he spent his time evangelizing in Athens. And the main thing that we read about in Athens is that it was a city full of idols. So the people of Athens worshipped a large amount of false gods and idols. And we read about this in verse 16. We're told that Paul is greatly distressed by the amount of idols that he sees in the city. And actually, back in the day, there was a saying about Athens that it was easier to find a god than a man in Athens because of the amount of idols that were there. So you know the ways you walk down Lisburn Main Street and everywhere you look, it's either charity shops or coffee shops. Well, in Athens, it would have been idols. But it wasn't even a case of there was an idol here and there on a street corner or two. But actually, as you walked around, every door and every business and every street would have been literally filled with idols to all sorts of false gods. And so this morning, that's what we're going to think about. So as the people of Athens struggled with idol worship and their search for the true God, actually, how today as Christians do we still wrestle as well with the worship of idols? And actually, what can we learn from Paul's teaching about how we deal with those struggles? Now, in our context, idol worship is very different. It's very unlikely that any of us at home have a physical object of a different god that sometimes we're maybe tempted to worship instead of Jesus. But the late Tim Keller really helpfully defines modern-day idol worship as this. So he says, an idol is anything that is more important to us than God. And to unpack that a bit further, he says, an idol is anything that captures our heart and imagination more than God. An idol is anything that we seek to give us what actually God can only give. And an idol is anything that is so central and essential to our lives that if we were to lose it, life would hardly feel worth living. And so essentially then, any idol in our life, although initially it may seem to offer us fulfillment or purpose or worth or whatever it may be, is actually only a cheap imitation of what God truly wants to offer us. So I want you to imagine for a minute, if you were given the choice between an all-expenses trip to New York for a week, okay, very glamorous, or an afternoon in Bow Street Mall, I wonder which one you would pick, and I'm pretty confident you would probably go for New York. And the thing is, both at the heart are similar. But the experience you would have for a few hours in Bow Street Mall, it would be vastly inferior to the experience you would have for a week in New York. Okay, the mall would just feel like a cheap imitation compared to a shopping trip in New York. And this morning, as we think about idols, I want to be really clear. This is not about a guilt trip or a telling off for the idols that we struggle with in our lives, because the reality is we all have idols. But through our Bible passage this morning, we are given an invitation to lay down our idols, because what they offer us is just a cheap imitation of the fullness of life that God promises and offers to each of us. And so this morning we're going to think about three things. Firstly, that all of us search for fulfillment. Secondly, that our idols will only fail us in that search for fulfillment. And thirdly, that actually it is only through Jesus that we will find the true fulfillment that he desires for each and every one of us. And so firstly then, as we think about our search for fulfillment, we're told this in verse 23. Paul says, "For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' So you're ignorant of the very thing you worship, and this is what I am going to proclaim to you." So Paul, as he walked around Athens, saw many, many idols, but one of the idols that he highlights in particular was an idol they had made to an unknown God. So essentially, the people in Athens, despite all of the idols that they already had, they were actually afraid of missing out on worshipping an unknown god in case they'd missed any of them out, and they didn't want to neglect that god. And so Paul, as he addresses the people of Athens, recognizes that they are searching for truth, and that despite all the idols that their city is filled with, they're still not actually sure whether or not they have found the true God that they should be worshiping. And actually, this highlights a basic human instinct that all of us have, and that we are all searching for something. And there was a psychologist named Abraham Maslow who put together what was known as the hierarchy of human needs. And in it, he recognized three areas that all of us will have as humans, needs. So we all need love and belonging. We all need safety and security. And we all need a purpose if we are to experience fulfillment. And in the beginning, Adam and Eve, before the fall, they experienced all of those needs met perfectly through relationship with God. But the consequence of sin and the fall is that because sin has entered the world, that has caused a distortion in us as to where we seek to find our fulfillment. And so that actually means even for us as Christians, instead of looking for these things in relationship with God, what can happen is it leads to idol worship in our lives. And this is what we see happening to the people of Athens. So even though they were searching for the one true God, they had settled for idol worship. They were looking to those other idols to satisfy their basic needs. And in Athens at the time, one of the prevalent beliefs was from a bunch of people called the Epicureans. I think the Epicureans would be a great name for an indie band. If I was a teenager, I'd definitely have used that for my band. But essentially, their goal in life was to experience the most amount of pleasure possible. So they wanted to live the good life, but at the same time, they did everything they could to avoid anything that would cause them pain or hardship or cause them anxiety. And so pursuit of pleasure was a big part of the culture in Athens. And interestingly, things haven't changed too much even now in our culture and society. And actually, maybe even in our own lives this morning, that's our objective. How can I live the good life? How can I avoid anything that will make my life difficult or uncomfortable? And so that's firstly what Paul has highlighted to the people of Athens, that they are searching for fulfillment. And secondly, what we learn from Paul is that in our pursuit of that fulfillment, any worship of an idol in our lives will always fall short of the worship of the one true God. So in verse 25, Paul teaches the people of Athens that God, not their idols, is the true provider. And it says this, and he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. And I want to highlight that second half of verse 25. So God himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. So what Paul is doing here is he's challenging the illusion that the people of Athens have, that their idols are their providers. And he is showing them that despite what they believe, it is not their idols that can provide for them, but it is only God alone who can offer them true salvation and fulfillment. And as we reflect on our lives, even as Christians, it can still be very easy to look to idols instead of God to satisfy our needs. And the pastor, Matt Chandler, really helpfully highlighted four core areas of how we can look to idols to provide for us. So firstly, we can look to idols to provide us with a sense of power. So for example, when I get enough success or influence in my life, if I can just climb the career ladder high enough, that will provide me with the affirmation of power that I need, and then I will know true fulfillment. Secondly, we can look to idols to provide us with a sense of approval. So if I can just get enough affirmation from others, if I can be popular and well-liked, if I can be loved by as many people as possible, then I will know true fulfillment. And finally, then, we can look to idols to provide us with a sense of control and comfort. So if I can just make X amount of money, if I can live a certain lifestyle, if I can have a certain quality of life, if my kids can go to a certain university and have a certain career path, then I will know true fulfillment. And I want to be really clear this morning. I don't want this to feel too heavy, okay? There's nothing wrong with wanting to work hard and make the most of the opportunities and the abilities that God has given us. There's nothing wrong with wanting good and healthy relationships in our lives. There's nothing wrong with wanting to enjoy life and to provide a good life for those we love. But where the problems start is when, as Tim Keller said earlier, it's those things that become the source of our fulfillment. When actually we can't imagine being content in Jesus without having those things. And actually, when those idols become the measure of our success and our worth, that is when they become idols. And actually, very often, idols are just a subtle distortion of the good things that God wants for us. Going to humiliate myself with this illustration. So when I was a teenager for years and years, there was this girl in our youth fellowship that I really, really liked. And after a few years, I eventually got the courage up to ask her to our formal. And she said yes, so happy days, that was great. And then after the formal, I asked her if she wanted to go out sometime, and I got totally rejected. And after that, you know, life didn't have meaning anymore. I was like, how could I possibly ever find purpose or happiness in life again now that this relationship is gone? So really silly illustration, but again, it's that subtle distortion. Okay, there's nothing wrong with wanting a relationship, but actually when it becomes such a big thing that we don't feel our life can be truly fulfilled or that Jesus is no longer enough for us, that's when it becomes a problem. And the problem with idols is that they only imprison us, okay? Because if we don't have the career success or the influence that we long for, if we're not loved by everyone, if we actually realize that other people are more popular than us, if we don't get the lifestyle we want, then we will be crushed by life, and it will feel like a disappointment to us. And even if we do manage to get all these things, if they are our idols, we will just live in fear of losing them. And so as Paul leads to show the people of Athens, it's only through contentment in Jesus that we find freedom from our idols. Because actually it is God alone who promises to meet all those needs that we can mistakenly search for in our idols. And so actually, even if we were to lose those things that we thought we needed to be fulfilled, we can be confident that Jesus promises to be with us and that he will teach us true contentment. And so finally then, as we come to close shortly, we find that although our idols will fall short and fail us as we seek fulfillment or as we seek security or a sense of control, what we learn from Paul is that God is the one who promises to meet every need. So after Paul has shown the people of Athens how their idols are ultimately just an illusion of provision and control, he then points them towards the answer, which is the worship of and relationship with the one true God that they have been searching for. And so in verse 28, he says this, he says, "For in him we live and move and have our being." So in other words, it is in God alone that we find our provider, that we find our true sense of worth, our true sense of purpose, and our true sense of fulfillment. C.S. Lewis once famously said this. He said, "If we find ourselves with a desire that nothing in this world can satisfy, the most probable explanation is that we were made for another world." And idols can be a difficult topic for us to think about because it requires us to be willing to be honest with ourselves and to reflect on actually where are our priorities right now as followers of Jesus. And it requires us to recognize that even though we love and follow Jesus, it's very likely that we struggle with some form of an idol in our lives. Tim Keller again, he said, "Everybody worships. The only choice we get is what to worship." So in other words, if we do not put God in first place as the object of our worship, then we will put something else there instead. And so really practically, as we seek to discern our idols, what are the things that we think about and care about most in our lives? And how do we spend our money and our time and our resources? Does how we live actually match up with what we say we believe? And as we take time to recognize these idols, and as we have a willingness to admit that they are actually there, the good news, as we learn from Paul in verse 28, is that God wants to free us from idol worship, and he offers to be the one who gives us true fulfillment. And so actually the way we overcome our idols is through developing a deep love for Jesus. It's by filling our minds with the truth of his word. And we need to recognize and confess what our idols are, but it is equally as important that in their place we seek to be a people who know Jesus more and more. And I want to be vulnerable for a minute this week as I prepared this. I was actually really praying and reflecting and asking God, actually, God, what is the big idol in my life right now? And I would actually say the biggest idol for me right now is a desire for ministry success. And that comes from a genuine place of I really just want to see people come to know the Lord. And genuinely, I just want to see God's church grow to become everything it's meant to be. And genuinely, I want to see the community transformed for God. But actually, where that becomes an idol for me in my life is when I allow how well I think the church is going or how many people are coming to faith or how many people are attending things to be the measure of my worth and my success. And as I said earlier, that's when the subtle distortion of a good desire becomes an idol. And actually, when success in ministry becomes my measure of worth and success, then I will always be chasing something. I will always be wanting more. And I will never be satisfied or feel good enough. And actually, if in my lifetime, my ministry, the church doesn't grow, or people don't come to faith, then that ultimately will crush me. And I will feel like a failure. But the good news and what Jesus wants to do and free us from idols is that actually when I focus on Jesus, when I recognize that his love for me is unconditional, that actually he will love me regardless of how my ministry goes, when I focus on the truth of knowing that true success is knowing I have been faithful to Jesus, and knowing that I have pleased him, that brings total freedom from the idol that I make of ministry success. And actually, I would far rather choose the love and affirmation of Jesus than the insecurity of the idol of ministry success. And how much better a place it is to live and minister from knowing that I don't have to earn the approval or love of Jesus, that he has already given it to me and to each of us. And I want to be honest and share that this morning to hopefully help each of us consider how we may have allowed other things. Again, even if they're good things, even if they're well-intentioned, that subtle distortion again, how we've allowed those things to become idols in our lives. How maybe we have allowed those things to become our measure of success or of our worth or where we find our fulfillment. I love this wee quote that says, when you truly understand that Jesus died to make you his treasure, that will make him your treasure. And essentially it means that overcoming idols, we do it through recognizing that Jesus is our ultimate treasure, that he alone is the one who truly satisfies us. And an important thing to remember, too, is that removing our idols is a lifelong journey, okay? So we will always wrestle with the desire for things of this world. When Beth and I first moved to Lisburn, we had these big dreams that we were going to be incredible park runners, and we were going to go every Saturday and be super committed. And we went, the first week we went, we slept in, so we were late. We couldn't find the starting line. It was really cold and wet, and we just walked maybe half of the whole distance we were meant to. And then we give up, and we never did a park run ever again. But maybe there's still hope. But actually, to become good park runners, that would have taken persistence, okay? That was never going to happen just once overnight. And actually, overcoming our idols will take persistence. It doesn't just happen overnight, okay? We don't just confess them once, and that is the problem solved. It will be a lifelong journey of continuing to recognize and reject our idols. And every time they start to get hold of us again, in whatever shape or form that is, that we bring them before Jesus again, and we surrender them, and we choose him instead. And actually, as we persist in doing this, that's when they lose their power over us. And actually, our joy and fulfillment in him will continue to increase to the point that we won't even want to settle for anything less anymore than knowing and enjoying Jesus through relationship with him. So as we thought about earlier, there's freedom from the idol of power when we fill our minds with the truth that we don't need success or influence in our lives to get what we want. Because we can trust that as we follow the leading of Jesus, that if we're truly surrendered to him, he will place us where he wants us to be. Okay, he will open and close the right doors. There's freedom from the idol of affirmation when we fill our minds with the truth that Jesus loved us to the extent that he gave his life for us so that we could have relationship with him. And that we don't need to do anything to earn his love. And actually nothing we can do will make him love us anymore. There's freedom from the idols of comfort and control when we fill our minds with the truth that Jesus has promised to meet our every need. And actually, even if he doesn't give us everything we want in this life, we have the comfort of knowing that he has a good purpose in doing that. And we're reminded that actually our lives are not about us, but they're about him and his glory. And I think sometimes we forget that as Christians, that when we decide to follow Jesus, it's all about him. It's no longer about us. And so as I close this morning, very simply, I want to encourage us this week to really make space in prayer for the Holy Spirit to convict us of actually what might be an idol in our lives right now. And that actually with his help, we would choose to confess and surrender those idols. And we would recognize that that is going to be an ongoing process of repeatedly laying those idols down. And that we would seek his help to enable us to find true delight in our relationship with Jesus. And know that it is him. It's not our idols. He is the one who promises to give us everything we need to know true fulfillment. And ultimately, that we would not settle for the counterfeit that idols offer us. When we know that Jesus offers us the real thing. So let's take a moment in prayer. Let's pray. I'm just going to leave a wee bit of space for us to allow God to bring before us anything now that maybe has got a bit of a hold of us, anything that maybe is an idol for us. And maybe it is that idol of power, that success and influence matters to us. Maybe it's that idol of affirmation. That actually we are imprisoned by what others think about us. Maybe it's that idol of comfort and control. That we don't want to let go of some of the things that bring us comfort or make life easy. And God wants us to trust him even when it is hard. Father God, thank you that Psalm 16 says that in your presence is fullness of joy, that in your right hand are pleasures forevermore. And Lord, although this word this morning is a challenging one, although it causes us to reflect on where maybe our love and worship of you doesn't quite line up, Lord, we want to thank you that you're a God who is rich in mercy. We thank you as we know that Jesus came to set us free. And so, Lord, this morning in this space, but also this week, as we seek your help to recognize those idols, Lord, as we seek your help to know the places where they have a hold on us, where we maybe feel imprisoned, Father God, we pray that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you would set each of us free. And Lord, that as we lay down that counterfeit pleasure or fulfillment that idols try and offer us, I pray that each of us would grow to know, Lord, that true fulfillment, Lord, that true fullness of life, Lord, that abundance of life that you promise in John 10:10. Father God, we recognize this morning that we are weak. We recognize that we cannot do this, Lord, without your help. Lord, I pray that we, as your people here in Lisburn Cathedral, would just be marked by freedom, that we would be marked by a total adoration of who you are, Lord. In Jesus' name, I do just pray, Lord, that the grip of the things of this world would loosen their grip on each of us, Lord. And so we thank you for your goodness, Lord. We thank you, you promised to meet every single one of our needs. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. We're going to continue now in a time of prayer and intercession. Also to say that during the last block of worship, the final song, if you feel God is maybe speaking to you about idols in your life or anything like that, prayer ministry will be available.
In our prayers this morning, when I say, Lord, in your mercy, please use the response, hear our prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to gather together and to worship you, to realize your great love for us and to confess our sins to you. Please help us to live always in gratitude for your love and your patience with us and knowing you. Almighty God, you sent your Holy Spirit to be the life and light of your church. Open our hearts to the riches of your grace that we may bring forth the fruit of the Spirit in love, joy, and peace in all that we do. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, we pray for the world around us, for all those who work for peace and unity, and for world leaders, and pray that they will continue to seek an end to the suffering caused by war and violence, injustice and inequality. We pray for an end to violence and warfare in Israel and Palestine, so that the work of rebuilding communities, infrastructure, and society there may begin. Help us, O Lord, to affirm our common humanity, so that in our differences we may build together for justice and peace. Lord, we pray for the displaced peoples and families in Spain suffering from the flash flooding earlier this week. We pray for the emergency services looking to restore power and access to food and clean water for all those afflicted. We pray for the people who've lost their homes and livelihoods and possessions, and ask that your hand be upon them as they try to get their lives back in order. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Dear Lord, we pray for our church. We thank you for all those who are willing to lead us in our worship, to minister to us, to manage our administration, to guide our children and young people, to take services for us, and to help us in so many other ways. May we all remain secure in the knowledge that you are our Saviour and remain close to us in whatever lies ahead. Lord, we pray for this building in which we are gathered today. As we remember that people have gathered here on this site for more than 400 years, we reflect on our responsibility and obligation to preserve and maintain it for the future generations of Christians in this city, to give them a place together to worship. We pray for your provision, that you will give us the commitment and resources needed to upkeep the cathedral and the hall. Heavenly Father, we pray for all of the different groups and communities within our church family, for those that give of their time to arrange and lead events of all kind to serve our brothers and sisters in Christ. We ask that you give them energy and inspiration for their planning, and pray that they are well supported by volunteers to coordinate their ministry and acts of service. We thank you for all those who feel the call of ministry and service in our family, and pray that you will keep our hearts and ears open to opportunities to support our church and our communities in ways that glorify you, and which make full use of the unique gifts you bestowed upon each of us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, as our minds turn to the busy winter period that lies ahead of us, we pray for the events coming up over the forthcoming weeks. In particular, we pray for the remembrance events starting at the church towards the end of the coming week. May we not forget the sacrifice of so many in armed conflict throughout the years who gave their lives for us. And may the commemoration of the 80th anniversary of the D-Day landings remind us of our obligation to prevent such horrors from occurring again. We pray for the planning and preparations underway for the Christmas craft fair, and that it may be well attended and provides an opportunity for members of the local community to visit the cathedral and consider attending a service to hear the word of God. We pray for the children in our church family preparing for the upcoming transfer tests and their families too. We pray that your hand will be upon them in their preparation and revision, that you will give them calm and peacefulness, and that they will be able to work to the best of their abilities. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Everlasting God, we pray for ourselves that as we go from this church today to start the week ahead, we ask that in all we do, we may walk more closely with you at our side, safe in the knowledge that your love and care knows no bounds. We pray that you'll help us to discern you as the primary purpose in our lives and to find our contentment and fulfillment in you. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Oh,
Just as we stand, let's bow our heads to pray. Lord God, we pray that your Holy Spirit may flood our lives, that we may be overcome in your presence, that we may live in that presence, not just as we worship here, but in our lives minute by minute and day by day. And so now, pour the blessings of your Spirit, of your Son, and of your love fresh upon us this day. In Jesus' name, amen.